So, hello everyone and welcome to my talk on Horizon, the free EDA package I started working on for about like a bit over a year now. So to get started, let me explain to you why someone would write a brand new EDA package in 2016, even though like there were still many around. So these are my main points of motivation. Like first of all, I thought that the management of symbols and packages and stuff wasn't quite solved the optimum way I liked it. Also, supporting actual parts is still thing something I didn't see solved to my liking. As you may know, pretty much every EDA software consists of many editors like board, schematic, package, symbol, and stuff. And I wanted to unify all these so that these share code and share the same user experience. And another important aspect was to have a schematic editor that actually understands what you're doing and just isn't a program that lets you draw lines and labels and then figures out a netlist. I want something that really can help you with drawing schematics. And last but not least, I also placed emphasis on rule-driven design for meeting design rules and stuff. And some implementation details include like making use of explicit references. So not doing things like one a pin is connected to a net line if they happen to be on the same location on the sheet, or that like nets are connected if they happen to have the same name. And since programming also has to be fun, I found using modern OpenGL to be quite enjoyable, and doing a from scratch a program also gives the possibility to like try new things. So let me give you a quick overview of the implementation details. Horizon is written in C++ 14. This caused some issues in the past, since compilers still are getting smarter, even though I thought that these would be pretty mature already. It's about 50,000 lines of code without the included external libraries and dependencies. It's using GTK 3 for user interface, which gives us like things such as high DPI scaling for free. And right now it builds and runs on any reasonably modern Linux distribution and Windows. And it should run and compile on FreeBSDs as well. Unfortunately, Mac OS is out at the moment, since the Quartz backend of GTK3 on Mac OS doesn't support OpenGL. And I'm using JSON for a file format everywhere, since that makes interfacing with external scripts much easier. And everything, like really everything from like the pin to nets, symbols and stuff, it's all referenced by UUIDs. Since these are easy to create and they are practically unique by guarantee. So let me explain to you what I meant with the first point, with management of symbols and stuff. The classic approach is to have libraries. You have a library. In a library, you have like symbols or packages that have similarities, like being a resistor or being a logic gate. I didn't quite like that approach, since it's like having a file system with only one level of hierarchy, which doesn't make organizing things very easy. And these aren't also a database where you can just use SQL or something else to query. Instead, in the pool, it's like having just like one library. In the pool, even each item, like so, each symbol, each package and stuff, is all placed in its individual JSON file, which makes merging stuff easier. And since like having a bunch of files scattered around in a directory isn't that easy for searching. All of the metadata of these files gets scraped into a SQLite database, which makes searching a breeze. And to remove clutter and stuff, the pool is only supposed to contain parts that you can actually buy. So there won't be like a generic 10K resistor or 603 resistor in there. Instead, you should only like go to DigiKey and use the exact manufacturer's part number, since that's the only way you can generate a reasonable BOM. Yeah. So that's how the pool looks. Some of you may be familiar with things like symbols and packages, but what are these and why do we need these? First of all, let's start with the most tangible thing, the part. As I explained just before, a part is a real thing. So a thing with a manufacturing part number, where you can just go to a DigiKey, type in the part number, and you will get exactly the same part you want. So that also includes like slight variations such as temperature grade and stuff, but that's the way it has to be done to maintain consistency. Next on, there's the package. Packages are rather straightforward as well. It's just like in pretty much every other EDA package. You got your lines for silk screen and stuff. You got pads. You also got the usual additional layers such as courtyard or assembly outlines and assembly reference designators. But now things get a bit more special, namely how the pads are defined. Like many other EDA packages, just offer like a selection of basic pad shapes, but turns out that manufacturers, especially connector manufacturers, really like to create custom pad shape for whatever reason, and Horizon supports the out of the box. So a pad isn't something single like a rectangle. Instead, a pad stack is something that you draw, like anything else. So you basically draw your copper layers, place your drills, and all that. So arbitrary pad shapes are basically built in. Now that raises the problem: how to handle like simple pad shapes, right, like rectangles, without redrawing the rectangle for every single size. To solve this, pad stacks can be parameterized, and to do so, a pad stack can be accompanied by a program that's a custom stack-based language to keep things easy. It's deliberately non-Turing complete, so that it always terminates in infinite time. And it's basically just a way of writing mathematical expressions, so that the program can take external data such as like pad size or other stuff, and modify the pad stack itself to suit these requirements. Now you may be wondering where the pins are defined. Like you could go the traditional way and just define them in the symbol. But I didn't quite like that approach, since I wanted to really separate schematic from netlist representation. So that was out for obvious reasons. I also didn't want to specify them in the part, since you have many basically identical parts, such as like resistors. They are netlist wise, they are all the same. But so to do so, there are the types entity and unit. The unit is a thing that actually defines the pins. So you can think of the unit as things such as a single AND gate, a single NAND gate, as a single op amp, or in case of like parts that only have like one gate, for example, like a microcontroller, a simple one. There's only like, well, the entity just references the single unit, and the entity is a thing that groups the units and makes the like logical device out of them. This has the advantage that for the netlist only cares about the entities. So when we want to change a resistor from a 10K one to a 1K one, the netlist doesn't care, since the entity stays the same. There's just a note in the netlist that tells this instance of this entity, this component, it has this part. I guess a lot of some of this make it clear in the demo. So, and last but not least, there's the symbols. Symbols are pretty easy. They just take the pins as they are defined in the unit, and you're supposed to like draw all the usual simple stuff like the pins and the text for reference signatures, values, and all the other decorative stuff. These small arrows you see there, they are just for showing what's input and what's output. And as I already told, I wanted a schematic editor that actually knows about nets. So we could like always generate the netlist on the fly, but that seemed kind of silly to me. So that's how it's implemented. The netlist is edited in parallel with the schematic, and the actual connections are defined from the netlist and net names. So, and the schematic like reads the net names from the netlists for netlist and places the appropriate labels and stuff if they are there. as I lined out in my motivation, proper rules and checks are important as well, since in the end you want to manufacture your design. And it needs to meet certain rules, like the rules of the PCB house, and both your rules to ensure that the design actually works. Right now, there are things like set it, like rules can like actually set a track width. I'll show that in a demo how that works. Rules can match certain things, so a rule only gets applied if these things match. And rules can also be checked for, like clearances and hole size and track width and stuff. And these rules provide a framework for basically all things that can be checked. So we've got a framework that makes it easy to add like new checks for ERC, DRC, and style checks for like packages and stuff. Even though the project is rather young, I started working on it late 2016. It's been public since about a year now, and it's been actually like ready for public consumption for about 3 months. Like these are all the things that are working. Some of the things like the interactive router are leveraged from KiCad, since especially the KiCad router is developed rather separately of KiCad, since it has its own data model. It was surprisingly easy to integrate that. So right now, Horizon has the same awesome router that KiCad has, and also the handling of step models for import and export was also adapted from KiCad, as well as the calculation of the RedsNest air wires, since that's actually rather difficult. And to also support the like usual stuff like undo, redo, copy, paste, even though some of them are a bit as still an experimental. Yeah, so some things are still missing. Since my plan is to have like one global pool, there needs to be a convention in place that everyone adheres to. There's some work in progress that someone on the internet started and had some really, really good ideas. So I think that could go somewhere. And we could also adapt things from the KiCad library convention, since they did a really great job there as well. So last but not least, thanks to everyone that helped me in the project, especially friends and testers, many people on the internet such as on the EEV blog and microcontroller.net forum and on GitHub that felt issues and basically helped me. And also I'd like to thank the KiCad people, since without KiCad, Horizon wouldn't be what it is today, since without the router, things would be much less nice. Now let's head on to the demo. So there are basically two main entry points to user interface. For one, the project manager and the pool manager. I'll start with the project manager. So let's just open an example project, and open the schematic. So you got your usual schematic. So you can like draw nets just by dragging and starting from an existing junction. And now let's actually put there's a USB connector in there right now. Oh, just let me delete that one so I can show you how adding new things work. I select place part, then the pool part browser pops up. It's normally a bit better if you got a screen with a higher resolution. So let's place that USB connector. There's a preview of the symbol, and to the right there's a preview of the package, how it looks like. Just let me place that one like this, rotate it. And now I'll press O to add like a ground symbol that attaches like that. And just let me connect it just by clicking and dragging from there. And also let me add some labels to connect these. So let's just name this net like USB D minus and USB D plus. And now instead, so if I would like name like as unusual, and so I'll just rename this, then this will throw an error, since like now it created a second net with the same name, and that will cause a warning. And what I have to do instead is to use the tool to like move this net segment to another net. So like take these pins that are connected to this net segment at the moment and connect them to a new net. That makes things much more explicit. So I just connect this one to USB D plus, and this one to like USB, like USB D minus. And just because we can, let's make them, or if it's useful, let's make them a differential pair. That's as easy as that. So let's save that, go to the board editor, and go back to the schematic editor, and click place part to board, and this will pull up the board editor with the part at the cursor for placing it. Let's place it just here like so. And use the interactive router in its differential pair mode to just route this differential pair track to the USB pins of the microcontroller, just easy as that. And also, like, it supports all the things that you know from the CACAD router, like not making collisions and stuff. Just let's hope that this fits on the screen. That's how like the clearance rules work. You can add rules that like match certain nets. You can either match like net class or the net itself or the net name using a regular expression. And for each match, you can define you have your full clearance matrix. So like the minimum distance between these types of copper. And when looking for the right one, it just starts at the top. And looks for the first one that matches. Like I guess users of Altium may find this a bit familiar. Yeah, and there are also other rules such as like clearance from copper to non-copper things, for example, like board edges or holes, and also other rules for like for copper planes, and rules for track width. So if a track has its width set to be loaded from the rules, I can just alter the line, the track width in there, hit apply, and then it gets applied to all the tracks so that I don't have to change everything, and everything stays nice and consistent. Yeah, and I also got a 3D preview. Right now it takes a bit to load the models, since these are step models, and triangulating them takes a bit of time. So now they are there. And I have also some visual aspects, like I can change the background color. And some feature that actually might be useful. Let me turn off some of these. And to better see how the layers are stacked, that I can like explode these, so I can actually look into the PCB. Right now it's a bit silly, but I guess it's useful when you got PCB with many more layers. I also got some goodies. For example, instead of using the usual things for like box selection, I also have selection modes such as lasso. So I can just draw a lasso, and everything that's within it will be selected. Yeah, and as the KiCad people do, I also got like a selection filter. For example, I only want to select tracks, just select tracks, and it'll only select tracks and not like packages and stuff. Is that okay? Then it's time's up and questions, please. Go to the FOSDEM page and find the link to the GitHub repository and just like file issues, open pull requests and stuff. You're welcome.
Do you have some kind of IRC or something like that?
No, I don't have a dedicated IRC channel. But if there's a need for one, I guess we can just grab a channel or on Freenode or OFTC or so.
What happens if you delete a component on the schematic?
Yeah. Let me delete the USB connector I added. Just let me delete this in here. Press save to save the netlist, and then I'll press reload netlist, and then it's gone.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
This is great work, but maybe it's a stupid question, but why not just join KiCad?
Yeah. So the question was why not contribute to KiCad? As I explained earlier, I really wanted to implement the parts management the proper way, since how parts and symbols and stuff are managed is like the core of every EDA package. Like changing that would need changing everything. It also would have caused a lot of friction. Since, like as I said, the way how the symbols and packages are handled is really the core. So that's why I decided to start over.
Okay. Well, because historically in open source there's like one winner and the other ones just don't. Like by the time Git came out, there was Mercurial that was just on the cusp. Mercurial is great, but it just never caught on because Git got the whole thing. It's wonderful stuff. I don't want to criticize the work.
I had a similar question. I mean, in KiCad, the number one complaint of users is library management. So it looks like if somebody came to propose something, there would be fertile ground for discussion.
Yeah.
So did you try discussing with the KiCad team?
Actually, I didn't.
One thing I'm noticing here, which I'll sort of make the same comment but I'll make it in a different way. It seems everybody's inventing a new file format. you mentioned JSON. And I look at that and I'm thinking, well, JSON, XML style, C style, Lisp style, name all those things. They're really only an awk script apart. but what really matters when you look at a file format is how is it organized. And this is something that always comes secondary. And one thing that I've noticed about the formats that are used in layout schematics and stuff like that is that they're basically drawing formats.
Yeah.
That it's a drawing first, and the circuit that it represents is secondary. And what I kind of like to see is that flipped around, where the circuit that it represents is primary, and things like the placement and stuff like that is markup.
So how to repeat this?
The layout extension, the layout features that Verilog AMS has. That's one way of doing it because that's the way they look at it. But the bit about I see all these neat tools and they don't work together.
Mm-hmm.
But anyway.
one more question. Just yeah. Okay, three very quick questions.
You first.
Yes, please. Green T-shirt. Yeah.
Is the netlist that your program generates compatible with the netlist in other programs?
No. So the question is whether my netlists are compatible. No, they aren't. They are just JSON. Since my thought of storing things was just like serializing the internal objects, and compatibility in my opinion can be cared for by exporters.
Okay, one from Kaspar, yep. And then Tom.
Kaspar.
Yeah. Okay, so the question was whether it was hard to integrate the interactive router. Yeah, there were some impedance mismatches, such as the KiCad router, like thinking of things being connected if they are on the same position, like in Horizon, they are connected if they connect to the same junction. So I had to do some matching things in there, but it also required some changes to the canvas to like interactively hide things and stuff. But overall, it was doable.
Would you be able to pull in changes KiCad one is improved?
I did so once just by doing a git pull on the KiCad repo and using melt to merge changes over, since I didn't modify the actual router. Since all the interface between the router and the host application is in its own class.
Okay, last question.
It's actually a comment.
Yeah. Both.
No.
Okay.
Well, I'm asking because what I noticed, I'm actually one of the KiCad devs, so I noticed that most of the new projects are heavily maker-driven.
Yeah.
And these people mostly come from the IT background.
Yeah.
So that's why part management is a top priority for them. This is just my feeling. Because, we all hardware engineers,
Yeah.